We're glad y'all are here, and we just want you to know that you're going to get blessed. Brother Tim's just awesome. He always gives us a good word. And just a little bit about them. They moved to Falun, Sweden in 1991 or 92. 1992, the fall of 92, and pioneered one of the first two Domata schools that were pioneered. They were pioneered the same year, Estonia and Sweden, and they pioneered the Swedish school up there in Falun, Sweden. And I was there that first year for both schools, and then after, was it 2 years that you moved down to France? With three, after 3 years, they moved to Versailles, France, and Plaisir, okay, and pioneered the French Domata School, and remained there in France until they came home 2 summers ago, and they had the school, and then they started a church, and the church really became the main thrust of their ministry, and then the church has grown, and then they turned the church over to a French national, and it's going and doing well, and they're just, you know, they're back here waiting for new direction from God, but God's got them out traveling and doing things, so we're blessed to have them. They're always a blessing to have the Kilstroms. So let's welcome Tim Kilstrom as he comes. Hallelujah. Did Vicky want to say anything? She never wants to, does she? Yeah. Except at home, right?
Yeah. I'm trying to change her. She's a oneness preacher, and I'm the one.
Yeah. You never heard that before.
She's a oneness preacher, and I'm the one.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
Well, good evening. Praise the Lord. It's good to see everyone tonight. Praise God. Good to be back in Greensboro. Good to be in North Carolina, God's country.
Amen.
My mountains are prettier than Vicky's Colorado mountains. I tell her that all the time. I've even got my daughter's brainwashed. They'll tell her the same thing. Anyway, we better hush. I'm gonna get praise. What anointing I had is quickly leave now. Amen. Well, we were, as he said, we've been back in the States. I was trying to figure when the last time I was here, and he thought that we had been here since we've come back. Maybe that summer. You know, I'm going to have to keep a journal of these things. My wife keeps telling me I need to do that, but I'm trying to get her to get the hint to do it for me, but it's not working too good. But we came back 2 years ago, 2009. Actually, I was just that probably about April, sitting in my office and was getting ready preparing to preach for a Sunday morning, just looking at some scriptures about the Lord as our shepherd. I saw a reference in Numbers. I did not know there was a scripture about the shepherd or about a shepherd in Numbers. And it kind of caught my attention. I said, what's that doing in there? And I flipped it back, and it was when Moses was praying for his successor before he died that they would not be a sheep without a shepherd. So that was the reference. And when I saw that, the Holy Ghost fell on me and said, there's your assignment. Pray for your successor. And it kind of bothered me because Moses died. I had a talk with the Lord all day long about that part, you know. But it just says that the Lord said, I'm gathering you back to your people. Of course, he did die, and he went to his people. I was just coming back to here. And so I was glad about that part. But in 2.5 months, the pastor there was ordained and had him in place. And, he's just being faithful, keep going on. He sent me an email with some pictures. There were 9 baptized in water about a month ago, 5 brand new converts. So praise God. You know, and it blessed me. And that's going fine. We stay in touch. I haven't been back to France. I went back about 4 times during the first year. And just, you know, they need to walk on their own. Praise the Lord. And they are. Amen. And the same God that helped us will help them. You know, God's not a respecter of persons. The Word works. The Holy Ghost is the same. Amen. The name of Jesus is the same. And so they're doing fine. And last year, we spent a year helping Brother Mark Brzee do a second year of Domata. We called it Domata Advanced School of Ministry. He just kept having us stirring about doing something. He said, there's people in our church. They ought to be, you know, pastoring and doing things. He said, I can see it on them. Of course, in Tulsa, Tulsa's filled with people that get there and don't leave. Now, when I went there, Pastor Ken Jr. said, don't you dare stay. So I took his word for it, and I'm glad I did. I think that's a good thing for Bible school students to go to Tulsa and get out. But sometimes that doesn't happen, so there's a lot of people there that really, honestly, have calls of God on their life. And so they were a lot of them there in the church. And so after praying about it, he got a desire, the Lord spoke to him about a kind of like a school of pioneering. So I said, you get the details and, the vision, I'll fill in the details and help you for a year. And I'll tell you, it was one of the best years, Bible school students, I have ever had. We had 25 students, some of them been to school three years, different schools, Domata, Rhema, Assembly of God, Foursquare, different schools. But I'll tell you, it's like we had 25 preachers in that class. And some of them, they're already starting to do some things. Some of them are in missions right now. One of them went to Washington to pioneer a church. One of them started pastoring a church just a couple of weeks ago. One of my favorite ones. I learned a lot about and really had a change of heart about ministry. And even sometimes when I'm in a church, I'm trying to be a little bit more cautious about how I tell stories about how the Lord led me in ministry. You know, the principles are the same, but, you know, you may never get out of Dodge. You know, the Lord led us all over the world. And it is the same Holy Spirit. But God's plan for you is just as big. It's just as great to God. And this is one thing that opened my eyes. There was a guy there that wanted to come to the school. And we had a test that everybody had to pass. Well, he barely passed. I mean, it was the grace of God, the mercy of God, that he passed that test. But he had such a heart, he wanted to go back to the neighborhood that he grew up in Tulsa. Let me tell you a little bit about him. When he was 12, he and his twin brother were abandoned by their mother, and they raised themselves. Paid their own bills and everything. That's amazing. His brother, he's a little carnal. He's not quite sanctified. But his brother, he's very successful. He's like a millionaire. And he is successful as well. But he could not get away from having a heart to go back to where he was, you know, abandoned. And so all during school, he'd tell me about it. And I could tell there was something on him about it. So when school was out, he went to... Spent 2 weeks up at Bill Wilson's. How many of you ever heard of Bill Wilson up there in New York City? You know, it's got it's the largest kids' church Sunday school in the world. I mean, thousands. He just ministers to these kids. And not only that, now he's all over the world finding places where they have the need of this ministry. And so during the summer, we have a trailer that we go around, and I was helping with outreaches this summer. Pops out like a stage, and there's music, and we do puppets and minister to kids and then switch gears and minister to adults. And I said, whenever you're ready, let us know. So he told me he was ready. So we went to this neighborhood. Now, where he lived before, the apartments were not there, but right across the street was a government housing apartment complex. And they threw open the door, gave him all kinds of favor, like you just wouldn't believe. We went in there, had 125 people show up, 100 of them were kids, 25 kids got saved, 5 adults, and 13 families said, please come visit us. So I handed them those cards and I said, there you go. And I left. I didn't really know what he was going to do with them. I don't think he knew what he was going to do. But he started, you know, regularly going out there and being around those people and loving on them. He bought a bus, a small bus, and started getting them, you know, bringing some of them to the church. Well, they all wanted to come. He had to buy a bigger bus. And just a couple of Wednesdays ago, he bussed in some adults, plus kids, plus used 55 kids on a Wednesday. Wow. To the church. Glory to God. Amen. You know, that just goes to show you there are people in Tulsa that need to get saved. Well, if there are people in Tulsa that need to get saved, there are people in Greensboro that need to get saved. There's got to be some vision open up in the house of God to reach around, you know, where we live. And I believe there is. And God's going to speak to some of you about that. And when he does, just take it to heart. You don't have to go around the world. Thank God if you do. You know, that's up to God. But I tell you what, there's a harvest field right where we live. Yes. Amen. Well, let's lift our hands and let's thank God for His mercy and His grace tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You. We bless You. Praise God. Help us, Lord, to redeem the time that we're living in and to be ready to minister to the lost wherever we are, whatever station of life, wherever we live in this city or other cities, Lord. Glory to God. And Father, we lift up our time together with the people of God tonight. We look to You. We thank You for direction. We thank You for utterance. Hallelujah. We thank You for the leading of the Holy Spirit, the quickening of the Spirit of God. And Lord, as we just follow You, we know that as we follow the Spirit of God, then You'll manifest Yourself. You'll be able to do anything and everything You want to do. And that is our prayer, that Your will be done tonight, not ours, but Your will be done. So we thank You for it and give You praise for it in Jesus' name. And everybody agreed, said, amen. Amen. Well, I'm just going this direction because it was kind of funny. This morning, we were in Virginia. We're kind of entering a church there, one of those situations where there were some indiscretions and the pastor had to resign. And we were able to step in just for a little while, probably for a month or two, just to help him. And, you know, sheep need a shepherd, even if it's just temporary till they get the real one in there. They need help, and we were glad to do that. It's sad to be there under those circumstances, but we're glad on the other hand. And so we were praying for that service. I wasn't thinking about here. I was thinking about there, and I already had my message, and I was praying for them. And all of a sudden, I got this phrase from an old hymn. You remember the hymn, Victory in Jesus? You know, some of those hymns have long shelf life. I don't know. There's just something about some of those hymns. You know, there was just an unction on those writers. Maybe it's the way they lived or something, but it was imparted in those words. And there are a lot of times I'll be praying and worshiping, and I'll find myself singing. So you remember the hymn, Victory in Jesus? You know, Victory in Jesus, my Savior. Forever. Now listen to this. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me even before I knew Him. Amen. And He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That'd make a Baptist shout, I think. That's where I learned that song. Praise the Lord. But that phrase kept coming to me. He sought me and bought me. Sought me and bought me. I turned to Vicki, I said, sought and bought. I said, that sounds like an Ed Taylor sermon. I might have to preach. It just had a ring about it. So I get here, I kind of act like him. It, you know, that Pentecostal holiness on him kind of gets on me, and I become Baptist-costal all of a sudden.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, I like it. How about you?
Amen.
But anyway, aren't you glad that He sought us? And He bought us. Turn with me to the book of Colossians. Praise the Lord. I want to share with you some things just from the Word of God. Based on that, if you're going to put a title on it, I don't know if it'd help or not. But sometimes people always ask you at the end of the service, what do you call that? So I'll tell them in advance, sought and bought. Hallelujah. But in the book of Colossians, I want to read a portion of scriptures here and then just share something that happened actually when we came back the first summer we were back. The Lord began to show me some things out of the Word of God. So for our purposes tonight, we may not comment on all of it, but let's just start with verse 9, Colossians 1:9. For this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and ask that you might be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing Him, being fruitful in every good work. Or one translation says, your efforts in ministry be productive, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to His glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy. Or one translation says, keep on keeping on, always full of joy in the Lord. I like that, don't you? Giving thanks. He didn't stop there. Giving thanks. See, this is continuous. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us
to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness, conveyed unto us into, and conveyed us or translated us into the kingdom of his Son, in whom we have redemption. Have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Praise the Lord. I love those sections of scriptures. Now, the first part is talking about a prayer there, a prayer that Paul prayed. I remember several years ago, we were in Sweden. We were there 2 years, and I knew the time was coming, it was going to change, and so I started praying. You know, you can pray out the future. As a matter of fact, we're supposed to. You know, God knows the future, but it's your future, so if you want his future, you got to pray it. It's not just going to drop on you. And so I was getting ready to pray because I knew some things was coming, some changes, and the Lord surprised me, and he said, pray Colossians prayer for your two oldest daughters. And so you know what I mean by that. You understand by praying Paul's prayers for people. I'm sure Brother Ed's talked to you about that. You've had that many, many times. If you've heard Brother Hagin's tapes, you know what I'm talking about, where you just kind of put your name or somebody else's name in there, and you pray that for them. So I understood what he meant, but he said, pray Colossians prayer for Micah and Ryan. Now, at that time, they were 13 and 11. Now they're 31 and 29. But I didn't know what that meant. I didn't know if we were going to be traveling. I was going to go back to the States and be traveling, as you know, around the world, and they'd need more grace on them, or we were going to put them in public school there in Sweden. I didn't know what it meant. But I just knew the Holy Ghost said, pray for them. So I started doing it. Prayed for a month. Every day, you know, just at some point in time. Sometimes you'd pray longer, sometimes shorter. You know how sometimes that goes. Sometimes there's a stronger unction on it than other times. Sometimes I'd get praying in the Holy Ghost, and the unction to just be there and just go with it. So then it lifted. Didn't know what it was about. Came all the way to February of the next year, and we were sitting at a dinner table with a lady evangelist, and she said, is there changes coming in your ministry? And I said, yeah, but I don't know what it is. I just know something's coming. Well, my oldest daughter, if you knew her, she's pretty shy, pretty quiet, and she didn't start out that way. When she was born, she was wired. I mean, her hair, she just stood straight up. And she had a personality to match. But you know, I remember, this is a side story. You got to be careful what you say over your kids. But my wife kept saying, she's a cross between a tornado and an ever-ready battery. And one day her mother said, you better stop saying that about your kids. Thank God for moms. Yeah, yeah. And so Vicky changed and found a scripture that she has a meek and quiet spirit. Oh, wow. So she, at 2 years old, she got my daughter, my oldest daughter, to confess, Micah has a meek and quiet spirit. Well, it took. And so she's kind of meek and quiet most of the time. And so to my surprise, she jumped up and said, right in the middle of this conversation with this lady evangelist, she said, I believe I know we're going to move to another country, and I believe I know which country it is. And I'm in shock. And then the other daughter said, yeah, me too. And so I feel ganged up upon. You know, I know the Bible says he'll pour out your spirit on all flesh, and sons and daughters shall prophesy, but I didn't read they'd prophesy to you the parents. I didn't even see that in there. So this was kind of new. And so I just sense, how many of you know you can sense the Holy Ghost on things? Sometimes, especially with kids, you know, they're not going to put on stuff. They just kind of, you know, you just know. So I just said, well, girls, let's just keep it and let's just see what happens. You know, that's probably God, but let's just see. Really, I was waiting to get alone to see what was going on, so I could ask God to find out what was happening. And sure enough, as soon as I had a chance, I said, Lord, I need to talk to you about that. And he reminded me about praying that for my daughters. I'd forgot. Thank God, God don't forget. And he said, remember praying that. And this is what I said, yes. And he said, I'm teaching them how to be led by my spirit, and it'll be a lesson they'll never forget. Hallelujah. Well, that's good. I'm for that. Aren't you? Aren't you glad God wants to get involved in raising your kids and teaching your kids? I mean, if it was all I was going to do, it wouldn't go very far. Hallelujah. We do our part, but God does his part. And so I said, well, Lord, where are we going to go? And I started just kind of doing by process of elimination, praying things out. And that, when I said France, I said, what about France? Because that was the last place I thought. I mean, it was like a light bulb went, ding! I said, France, are you kidding me? Lord, this is the country coming to the city. If I go there, you got to be kidding me. I mean, I still don't know why he sent us for 14 years in France, other than the, you know, the foolish things confound the wise. That's the only thing I can figure. And so Vicky had the same witness, so we got our girls together and said, okay, your parents finally feel like we know what we're supposed to do. We feel like we're supposed to move to France. And they went wild, started running around the house. And my oldest daughter went and got a journal. She had it dated 6 weeks before. And this is what it said. I believe we're moving to France and Dad's going to start another work. Had it written down. Well, that's the Holy Ghost, isn't it? Well, I learned something from that, but they learned something from that, and we followed God. God's got a plan. And so he's talking about prayer, and that's the context here. But then he didn't stop. He said, giving thanks. All the while, you need to give thanks. Giving thanks. Continually giving thanks. What are we to thank the Father for? Now, I'm going to get back to prayer in just a minute. Just hold on. But I'm going to take a little side journey. We're talking about being salt and bought. Don't forget what the title is. And so it goes on to talk about in those verses that God hath, I mean, even though that's past tense, he hath qualified us. Whew, not going to. He already has. How did he qualify us? By the new birth. Yeah. He qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance. He did that. He delivered us from the authority of darkness. He translated us into the kingdom in whom we have redemption. Now that word redemption describes everything I just said. Everything that happened, being delivered, being set free, being in the kingdom, being born again, all has to do with redemption. Redemption is the biggest word in the Bible. Everybody say redemption. Now the word redemption means to be bought. To say I'm redeemed, you could say I'm bought by the blood, and you're saying the same thing, aren't you? Now, we don't use that word redeemed very much, do we, as far as in the natural? We use it in church, but outside the church, we don't. The only time I ever remember using the word redeemed was when we went to the S&H Redemption Center. S&H Green Stamps. Anybody remember the S&H Green Stamps? I mean, you know, my mama, she'd save up these books. We'd go in there with bags just to buy a lamp. Now, it's funny. You could go in there, but you couldn't spend cash. I mean, if you walked in there off the street and said, "Oh, I like that lamp. You know, I'll give you can, you know, how much, you know, I'll give you $100 for it." And they said, "Sorry, you can pay tax." You had to pay the tax, but you couldn't go in there and buy something. You had to have a book of green stamps to buy it. Well, that's a pretty good illustration. We're not bought with silver and gold, but with the blood. Amen. There was only one thing that could redeem us. So we're bought. Everybody say we're bought. Now, when we came back to the States, one weekend, there was a pastor down in Louisiana who was one of our Bible school students in a Bible school way back, had just started a church, and we were talking, and we agreed, and he wanted me to come on a weekend, on a Sunday morning, to preach. So, you know, it's about a six-hour drive from Tulsa to where he is. Well, I was going to leave on a Saturday, of course, drive down there. Well, I got a call, I think, late Friday evening. And it was from our former pastor, Pastor Sam Carr in Shreveport, Louisiana. We, you know, we worked with him for many years. They sent us out. He's still my pastor. He said, "Yeah, I hear you're coming down here." I don't know how he heard. But he did. He said, "We have service on Saturday night. I want you to preach for me." Well, I've only got about 6 hours driving to get prepared. He always did that to me anyway. Nothing's new. So I'm driving in the car, praying, just looking on the inside, and had just preached in the Bible school there in Tulsa on redemption. It's a wonderful subject, being bought, what that means, you know, being delivered. Like it, in the Greeks used it like buying a slave out of the slave market, never to be returned, but to be restored to what it was supposed to be to start with. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you're redeemed that way? So I was thinking about that, thinking about the concept of redemption, saying maybe that's what I'll preach on. And I was driving down the road, and all of a sudden, the presence of God came into my car. It just in there. Oh, aren't you glad?
Yeah.
The Holy Ghost can show up in some unusual places. And so I can recognize it, so I just begin to worship the Lord. And I heard this in my spirit. Now I want you to listen. This is where we're talking about being sought and bought. He said, redemption to you mostly means you getting your life back. You know, like Adam, everything we lost in the fall, we get back. Getting your righteousness, getting your healing, getting your blessings. How many of you know that's all part of redemption? Being born and getting eternal life. Thank God. That, you know, that's all to benefit us. And thank God that is what it is. Redemption is that. But this is what he said. Redemption to you is you getting your life back. Redemption to me was me getting you back. Hallelujah. Let me say that again. I want you to let that sink down on the inside of you. Because this is what I'm talking about. The Lord said redemption to you was you getting your life, your privileges, your authority, and all that back. But redemption to him, to the Father, was just him getting us back. Hallelujah. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means a lot. You know, we talk about us seeking God, but there's a higher truth. There is a truth of us seeking God. But let me tell you a higher truth. He sought us.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said the Father seeks those to worship him in spirit and truth. He wanted a family. He created us to fellowship with him. Adam forfeited that. He lost that, but God wasn't willing to give it up. He wanted us back.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So before the foundation of the world, ere before I knew him, he loved me. Somewhere way back there in eternity, God knew everything. And just because you make a mistake doesn't mean God falls off his throne. Hallelujah. He's got a plan. If we'll just run to him, man, he's got a plan. Oh, glory to God. Don't never run away from God. Run to God. And when you understand God's that way, it's his nature. He didn't want to lose us. He sought us. Yes, we sought him, but he sought us. Really, you found out when you finally found God, you found out he was looking for you. Amen. So we're sought and we're bought. That's the reason. We're sought. There's another side to redemption. It's not just you and your things. God sought you and he bought you. Hallelujah. There's another side to redemption, and that is being sought and being bought. See, I told you about being sought. I've talked about that and what it means to be, you know, God seeking us, and he wanted us back. But there's another side. Now you're bought. He sought you, and now he has bought you, and guess what? We belong to him. Oh, it makes a lot of difference when you see it this way. It even makes a difference. You know, I'm not going to talk a whole lot more on prayer tonight, but we could, because, you know, prayer is fellowshipping with God. But let me read something to you, and then I got another part I got to get to. Prayer should be as natural as breathing and as enjoyable as eating. Prayer should be as unconscious as our communication with each other. It should not be the child of need, but based on a fellowship with the Father and with the Master. Now listen, so that our needs are his needs, for we are not our own, we are part of him. Our body is not our own. Our property is not our own. Our abilities are not our own. They're his. We're laboring together with him. What we considered personal needs are really his needs. Boy, if we'd ever get a hold of that, I tell you, it'd make a difference in your prayer. You ever thought about that, what you need, God needs? If you belong to him and you're serving him and you're out to do his will and you're wanting his plan and purpose, then whatever you need, he needs. Even if it's $1 billion, because you're not doing it for yourself. Hallelujah. See, there's a missing element in prayer. There's a missing element in faith. There's a missing element in our consecration. And I tell you, it makes a lot of difference when you realize that I am sought and I am bought. It'll put you on a different plane when it comes to praying. I tell this story, and I probably told it here, but I tell it all the time because it just made such an impact on me. Years ago, we went to Vicky's home church. They were celebrating 70 years as a church. You know, been involved in missions, and she grew up in that church. And the pastor that was preaching this Sunday morning service was one of the pastors there back in the 50s. And this time, he was 86. Now, he's gone on to be with the Lord. He went to LIFE Bible School. And he said, and this is his own testimony, he said he went there, and after finishing Bible school, he made the decision that God couldn't use him. But God called him. You know, God calls you, God will equip you, and God will use you. But he made that decision. He didn't think God could use him, so he went back to farming. Nothing wrong with going to farming, but if God's called you to do something else, don't do that. Obey God. And he didn't. So he basically was running from God. And so something happened one day. He heard a cry and somebody screaming at the farmhouse, and he ran there. And when he got there, his wife had their 5-year-old daughter wrapped up in a blanket. She wasn't dead, but she was wrapped up in a blanket. And when he unraveled the blanket, her arm was completely mangled. She got it caught up in a wringer washer, you know, all the way up to here. Now, I know this lady. I didn't know this testimony. Her daughter was my wife's best friend growing up, so I never heard this. And so he said they took her to the doctor. The doctor said, there's nothing we can do. We're going to, you know, sedate her real heavily, bring her back tomorrow, and a surgeon will be here from Denver, and they'll amputate her arm. That's it. So, of course, they were devastated by that. So that night they went home, put her to bed, and they went downstairs. They're, you know, old-timers, you know, believing, praying, seeking God. So they went down to the basement and said, we got an old tarpaulin, and pulled it over us. And said, while we're there, we started off praying like this. Now listen, see if you can hear the difference. Father, if you heal our daughter, we'll serve you. But he said, you know, something started changing during the night while they were praying, and we changed, and we were praying like this. Lord, we'll serve you. Now heal our daughter. You hear the difference? Now, there's no doubt God's answered that first prayer. He's probably answered some of mine that way. But there's a point in time he wants us to grow up. See, we're sought and bought. We're sought and bought. We belong to him. Amen. And so we begin to realize that it's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. It make a lot of difference in your prayer, your living, everything, and your purpose in life and what you'll be able to accomplish. And when you realize you're sought and bought. And so so they changed their prayer and said, Lord, we'll serve you, now heal our daughter. Well, they took her back the next morning, just like the doctor said, and they started unraveling the gauze, and there was fresh skin there. And she just, and to this day, the last time I saw her, I checked out the testimony, make sure it's the right testimony. I told her, I said, I tell your testimony everywhere I go. Is that true that, you know, and she said, yeah, see. That's her testimony. All these years. And the doctors say, they look at it and say, you're not supposed to move your arm that way. You can't do that. She said, but my arm's stronger, this arm's stronger than that arm. Hallelujah. It's kind of a double miracle. Well, you know, so he learned the lesson that I belong to God, now pray. Not trying to plead with God, not trying to get him to do something, not even trying to, you know, coerce him into doing something. I belong to him, now let's pray. And you know, that'll change your prayer a lot, because it'll eliminate selfish praying. Amen. But it'll make you more targeted to what you're praying for. So everybody say, I'm sought and bought.
I'm sought and bought.
Now go with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. Praise the Lord. Here we find that thought again. I'm just kind of speaking out of my heart. Is that all right? Everybody say, I'm sought and bought. See, to be sought was God's desire, not to lose us. But once we're bought, we need to understand that there is there's a price on your head. You belong to God. Hallelujah. Now let's see here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Everybody found it? 6:19. Or, I'm reading out of the New King James Bible. I'm trying to change, but it's hard. King James says, what? Know ye not? I like that better. But the New King James says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Who is what? In you. Whew. That's a good place to stop and shout right there, huh? He's in you, who you have from God. Now don't stop there. And you are not your own. Now, first of all, notice he said, what, don't you know this? I think it's interesting. He's writing to Spirit-filled Christians, Holy Ghost, tongue-talking Christians, and two times in 1 Corinthians, he said to tell them, don't you know? I visited Corinth years ago. We went to the old ancient ruins, and they gave us a map, and so I was able to look at the best they could figure, what was here, what was here, what was here, and I counted 19 different temples to different gods. So you can imagine what a revelation that was for Paul to write to them and said, what? Don't you know you're the temple? Whew, hallelujah. Boy, that's a revelation. Amen. That we're the temple of God, that the Spirit of God is in us. But you got to know it. You need to know it. It's important to know spiritual things. It don't just fall on us. We have to know things. If we don't know them, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. So we have to know it. So he just drilled that into them. So it's important to know. We could take off for a few minutes on that, but I'm not going to go there. I wanted to get to this part. Who is in you? Everybody say, the Holy Ghost is in me.
The Holy Ghost is in me.
And you are not your own, for... Hallelujah. Now, why are we not our own? For you're bought. See, that's what the Lord, that's that phrase I had, sought and bought. For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are His. Oh, my. I tell you, this is called, when you see these scriptures like this, and you see what the Lord's saying, you begin to understand, I call it the other side of redemption. We've been redeemed to God. We've been redeemed back to God. He created us to begin with, and we're His twice, by creation and redemption.
Amen.
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 And see, we belong to Him, and when we understand the sought and bought part, when we speak, it should change the way you live. It should change. We live consecrated lives. when we were in France, our praise and worship guy, there's another whole story about that whole thing. It was kind of interesting. That was just one area where I just had problems with for several years with the praise and worship. Somebody told me one time, I didn't believe it, but nevertheless, it was just people speaking out of frustration and experience, that when the devil fell from heaven, he landed in the choir. You ever heard that? Now, I don't believe that, but I'm just saying we had problems there. And I didn't want to run in and always be the bad guy. So, I just would smile, but it just frustrated me. So one day I was praying about it. And I wasn't praying. I call it stewing in the Holy Ghost. And minus the Holy Ghost. I thought I was praying. I was really stewing in tongues. I don't know how far I was getting. But thank God for the Holy Ghost. He broke through anyway. And I heard, it's like I heard a tape of Brother Hagin saying, Dub, you don't know how to put the greater one to work. I don't know if you ever heard that tape, but he's talking about how Dub, that's his brother. Anybody ever heard Brother Hagin talk about Dub? That was his brother. Well, his brother got saved later in life. Dub said, I'm going to go straighten out some family business. And Brother Hagin said, are you sure? And he said, yeah. So he went down there and came back and had a bad report. He said, I almost got in a fight and all these problems and everything else. So Brother Hagin said, Dub, you just don't know how to put the greater one to work. And I thought, what did he mean by that? Well, he is in us. And so the Lord began to show me about how to put the greater one to work, and that's another story. And so I began to see change in our church, and the first thing that happened was this guy got saved, and then another guy got saved. He was from Spartanburg, South Carolina. Actually, he's French, but grew up in Spartanburg, and they both played the guitar. But they got saved in my church. Well, when he got them saved, he got their guitar saved too.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And so after about a few months, I could see that. I could see God's plan, but you got to be careful not to rush it. Because, they're not quite ready. Not for leadership. They might be ready to play, but they're not ready to lead. There's two different games. There's two different things there. Well, one of the reasons why I wasn't so quick to Jean-Claude was his name. I wasn't so quick to put him in leadership because he still smoked. Now, you'd have to live in France. You know, every other guy smokes in France. It's true. It's just common. They just do it. And, years ago, America used to be that way. You know, I knew growing up in church, all the deacons had a little place where they put out their cigarettes going in and out of church. I had a Baptist pastor tell me, said, son, smoking won't send you to hell probably, but it might get you to heaven quicker. Yeah. And he was probably right. But anyway, I don't think it's a good testimony. I don't think it's a good thing. And I certainly don't think it's good for a leader. It's just not a good example. You follow me? So I was cautious about doing anything, and I was almost considering talking to him about it. And he'd been saved about 3 or 4 or 5 months at this time. Well, one day he came to me and said, I got a victory. I said, really, Jean-Claude, what was it? He said, well, I was reading my Bible, and I was reading here in 1 Corinthians 6:19. What know ye not that your body... He said, I was smoking a cigarette. No, I know you not that your body. Now, he said, I was just taking a puff. And I stopped halfway. Your body was the temple of the Holy Ghost. He said, man, it hit me. And he said, I put down that cigarette. And he said, all the desire left me. It was totally delivered. Well, that's a sanctifying effect. See, but here, you're what? Know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost who's in you, who you have from God, and you're not your own? For you were bought. See, that's the motive. That's why we live. That's why we live holy. I'm bought. See, holiness for a long time has been, for the Pentecostals, they had it right. You're supposed to live holy, but they made it a clothesline religion, where it was just outward. But I'll tell you what will give you a motive for holiness is to realize you're sought and you're bought.
Amen.
It changes everything. It'll change so se combro for what day in sahangonda ha ha ha. E zoro froche he de bachele conomba. Angresto horre peis so arriche calamumbo fahandea. O riste he chalaba pabrishke listo hobotsta. For the love of God is the strongest motive. The grace of God even leads you to repentance. And the plan of God will cause you to rise up and walk in a new place and in a new way and in a higher place with God. So as you let these truths sink upon your heart and into your spirit, that you're sought and that you're bought, it'll have a reaction, yea, a chain reaction upon your life, not only changing this to this and that to that, but it'll rearrange your whole thing. Your prayers will change, your speaking will change, your living will change, and the manifestation and the power of God will change in your life as well. So rejoice that you're sought and bought. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, I think we ought to raise our hands and worship God.
Hallelujah.
I think we ought to just tell Him, Lord, I thank You that You sought me and that You bought me and that I am not my own.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, consecration and holiness ought to be a worship. Hallelujah. Shouldn't be a drudgery. Hallelujah. David said, worship God in the beauty of holiness. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, sought and bought. Sought and bought. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Oh, we thank You, Lord. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, yeah. So Provence to hook and a mapanite in ha ha ha. Oh, richa humaha. Evo so puva teki a sosto rotore micheli ha. A deli costa horapanisti hikrin non to hamaha. And even the things that you desire and the things that you need and the things that you know need prayed about. Yes, even this way and the way you do it will change. For take the healing that you need. Oh, you're already bought. You're already paid for. Your body belongs to Him. So as you make your consecration to serve Him, then the upkeep is up to Him. And He'll surely keep it strong. And He'll surely keep it healthy. And He'll surely fill it with strength and life so that you can run your race and fight the good fight and win and finish and see Him in glory again. Ha ha. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Whew. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, there's something better than healing. It's called health. I said there's something better than healing. It's called health. If you glorify God in your body that belongs to Him. Oh, my. Hallelujah. Oh, let's just, I tell you, there's just a spirit of worship in this place. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Why don't you just worship him and tell him? Yield yourself unto him. Make a fresh consecration. Oh, hallelujah. The Bible says to present our bodies to God as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable, which is part of our spiritual worship. It's part of worship. Hallelujah. Just take time to say, thank you, Father. You sought me and you bought me, and I respond. I respond to your love. I respond to the price that was paid. Hallelujah. I belong to you, and my needs are your needs. And my body is not in my own. So thank you for making it strong. Thank you for making it healthy. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. For my purpose while I'm here on this earth is to live the life of God, to run my race and finish my course. And so while I'm doing it, I don't have to struggle with these issues. I just decide and make sure I'm walking with you, walking in fellowship with you. Ha ha. And as I do that, Lord, oh, you'll bring things in tune. And you'll fine-tune my body. You'll fine-tune my mind. You'll fine-tune me all the time so that I'm walking in the light and not in darkness, walking in strength and not in weakness, walking in health and not in sickness. Hallelujah. This is your plan. A plan divine. Whew, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 I tell you, there's just a spirit. If you'll just begin to worship God, the Holy Ghost who's in you will just begin to gush out. He'll begin to gush out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Zandegra Sombre Deste. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just worship him. Let's thank him that he sought us and that he bought us and that he loved us. Hallelujah. Oh, my. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, that's why we can cast all our care on him, for he cares for us. That's why we don't have to carry life's burdens. Woo, hallelujah. Ha, 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 ha. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So supreve tekelina. Nora, nora, kima, lanse. Eh, shoho, bo, shehe, bo, shehe, bo. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just keep worshiping him. Just keep worshiping him. I tell you, the Holy Ghost can make some adjustments. God can work in us. Hallelujah. Some of you need to say, Lord, your will, not mine. Your plans, not mine. Your glory, not mine. Hallelujah. Take the time right now to make a fresh consecration to him. In worship. In seeking him. But understand, he sought and bought us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sought and bought. Sought and bought. Hallelujah. And a rooster. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I tell you, it's going to change the way some of you have been praying, the way you see things. Hallelujah. Your faith is going to take up to another level. And that thing you've been struggling about, it'll either just go away or it'll just become real easy to pray. That's what the Lord said. There's somebody here that you've been struggling about something, but it's changing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it'll either just go away or all of a sudden you're just going to find it really, really easy to pray. To pray about that, to cast that care on him. To see God work, to see him come in strength and power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And turn things around. For you're his child. You belong to him. You're sought and bought. Yes. You're sought and bought. And your needs are his needs. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are others of you. You might want to take time just to pray that Colossians prayer. Oh God, fill me with the knowledge of your will. You've been wanting to know about God's plan. Well, he's waiting for us to make our consecration. He's already got the plan. Hallelujah. He sought you and bought you for a reason. For a plan. Hallelujah. So just begin to pray. Lord, fill me. Fill me. Show me. Show me. Fill me with the knowledge of your will. In all wisdom and spiritual understanding so I can take the steps. Worthy of you. Be pleasing. Be fruitful. Increase in the knowledge of God. Be strengthened with all might. Hallelujah. Running and not being weary. Walking and not fainting. Woo, hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Now, Lord, just show us what you want us to do. Show us your plan. Show us your directions. And we'll just spend time in fellowshiping with you, finding out what it is, and then we'll just stay there and get all the grace we need, all the needs we need, all the finances we need, all the favor we need, all the power and anointing we need to do it, because it's your will. We're doing this together. We're in fellowship. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Sought and bought. Sought and bought. Hallelujah. 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 I tell you, there's some changes coming. You've been waiting, wanting to know what God had for you. But I tell you, when you give it up to him and say whatever, wherever, whenever, whoo, then he'll begin to give you open ears. And you'll begin to hear. You know, Jesus knew what the Father wanted him to do. He fellowshiped with him and he'd say, I go out and do whatever I hear the Father say. I go out and do what I see the Father do. That's the way we're supposed to live too. Oh, ha ha. For his Father is our Father. His God is our God. He's the God and Father of the Lord Jesus and the Father of the family and the Father of our spirit. Ha ha. Oh, my, my, my. Hallelujah. 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 I said hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. So things are going to begin to change. Things will clear up. Yes, for some of you, in just the next few days, you're going to see things clearer than you've ever seen. For you've been walking around in a haze, not knowing what to do. But now that you've made your consecration, you've prayed through. And now that you're through on praying ground, it'll be easier to know what to do. And you'll just go out taking steps of faith. Yes, with a joyful sound, with even praise. And all the mountains and the hills will break forth before you, and there'll be shouts of joy. Hallelujah. And things that were hard before will seem easy now because you're walking with the Lord. Ha 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 ha. You know, when I say those things, I'm just speaking out of my spirit. It's the Holy Ghost. But a lot of times that's for somebody. You just grab a hold of it. You just grab a hold of it. Just grab a hold of it. Fellowship divine. All because he sought us and he bought us. Oh, my, 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 my. Bought with a high price. Bought with a precious price. The precious blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He loved me ere I knew him. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, really, be honest, it's us that's made it difficult, not you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We yield to you. We yield to you, Lord. We yield our lives to you. We yield anew. I tell you, there's just a sweet spirit in here. It's a good chance just to spend time. Just, you know, don't wait on me. Just fellowship with God. Just talk things over with him. Learn to talk things over with the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, come, let us plead together. Hallelujah. Glory to God. 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 Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, susunda rubatagi sianonga. Ah, ha, 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 ha. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Susundora fahalinga hina nora timazuda. Ah, ha, ha. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's right, Lord. That's exactly right. That's what that does. That's what that does. It puts us into a following position where we're following you, being led by the Spirit of God. Oh, you're out front, going before us, making crooked places straight. Hallelujah. It makes it even easier to walk by faith. Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. For we serve Jehovah Jireh, the God who sees ahead and provides. Oh, my. Hallelujah. You see our heart. You hear our prayer. You hear our faith. Woo! And you've already heard it, so you've already done it. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it's your desire. The eyes of the Lord are over the righteous. His ears are open to their prayers. So just talk to him. Just talk to him, church. Just between you and the Lord. Just talk to him tonight. Talk things over with him. Talk to him about that thing, that struggle, that difficulty. Come boldly to the throne of grace, the Bible says, to receive mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Yeah, there's help. There's help. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Yes, 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 yes. We thank you. Giving thanks unto the Father. Giving thanks unto the Father. We give you thanks, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus. We thank you for the blood. We thank you that you sought us and bought us. You were not willing to lose us. It was all your doing. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. And this is the day that the Lord has made, and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. We'll rejoice in you always. We'll pray without ceasing. And in everything give thanks, for this is our part in the will of God. We'll do our part. What a part! Oh, to rejoice, to pray in fellowship with you. Oh, to give thanks. My. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, what a life. The divine life. Walking in fellowship with God. My. What a privilege. What a privilege, Father. You've called us into the fellowship of your Son, Jesus Christ. Called into the fellowship. Hallelujah. My. Yeah. Soto orotose. Neneri talamasute. Yeah, sundakura lama nika diasona. Ahaha. Yeah, that's true. It's true. It's true. Sometimes, Lord, we've taken what we thought was faith, maybe just the principles, but left out the following you and the consecration too. And it just seemed hard. Oh, but it's different when we realize we're sought and bought. Oh, yeah, it makes faith strong. Puts us in a different place. Puts things in the right light. Ha ha. Oh. And the spirit of faith, it'll get stronger and stronger. Hallelujah. For we'll always just know that God loves us. He's gone ahead of us. He's got a plan in this difficulty. So we'll just start rejoicing ahead of time. Oh, look what the Lord is going to do. It's going to be good. Just wait and see. Just wait and see. Ha, 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 ha. And we'll start laughing at the devil, start rejoicing, start shouting before the walls fall. Ha, ha, ha. Hallelujah. And God is pleased with that kind of faith, and he'll surely come through for those who will believe him like that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, 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 Lord. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Bless
you. Thank you, Father. Bless the Lord.
Amen. Bless
his holy name. Lord, in your light we see light. Praise the Lord. In your light we see light. You will enlighten our darkness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Father.
Glory.
Thank you, Father. Bless the Lord. Praise God forevermore. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. One more time. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Hallelujah. Well, let's lift our hands one more time and worship him. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Lord, we worship you. Thank you for the time of fellowship with you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, glory. Well, I can tell you, I'm not preaching your sermon again, but your title is a preacher's title. Yeah. I've sat here all night thinking, I can't wait to go somewhere. And my next sermon, wherever I go outside of here, is going to be the salt and bought sermon, because I'm ready to lay it on somebody. Hallelujah. Man, I just got stirred up from the title.